things to one another are, well, what we know is that without a certain solidarity is my preferred word for it, without an understanding that there's a common interest as well as one's own raging individual demands and needs, which have always been understood at all times to be, in the case of any one person, insatiable, that unless these can be married in some way to a concept of the common good, then the enterprise isn't possible. And if this wasn't true, then of course we couldn't have had a human society, however primitive, to begin with. And the same conclusion is observable among other primates who have families, tribes, kinship, and so on, and some other mammals too. There's no reason to suppose that evolution has given us any special privileges in exchange for our recognition of these facts.
Thank you.
Can we each take a brief? Left unanswered is the issue of how evolved primates develop either individualism or solidarity. I've watched the Nature Channel a few times, and I don't see much of either. It seems to me that there's a missing element here, and I think Jefferson, who was, by the way, a man of the Enlightenment, not a particularly devout Christian, nevertheless asked, where do we as individuals get inalienable rights? In other words, where are the obligations, the mutual obligations to each other? Where do those come from? And he could have said any number of things, but he could think of only one. The unalienable rights are ours because we are created. We have a creator. That's where they come from. And I think to this day, we haven't had a better source of rights and of these individual dignities that Christopher Hitchens takes for granted, but makes no effort to ground.
Okay, then I'll have to, if you don't mind, because as a minor member of the Jefferson Biographer Club, I'll just have to say what I think about that. It is true that the Declaration speaks of inalienable rights from a creator. But in my opinion, this is a negation of what had been, up till then, the only way right was ever mentioned, which was that there was a divine right of kingship. If you recall, that's what was being overthrown, had already been overthrown in part in Britain, and was being overthrown in the United States. The claim of the king to have his authority from the creator was false. Now, if that claim is false, and I believe that it is, there is no divine right of kings, you can do one of two things. You can either say, well, if there are rights, then everyone should have them and claim them from the creator, which is a sort of tautology. Or you can say that rights don't come from a creator, that they are innate in us and in our species, and we'll get the ones we fight for and defend. We won't get the ones we don't. And most of the time, we're defending these rights against theocracy.
May I be offered just one thought? I think you are right that Jefferson is opposing divine right, but here's the truly profound thing. Rather than deny divine right completely, Jefferson makes a very different move. He transfers divine right from the one to the many. In other words, Jefferson shows by his statement that he agrees with divine right, but the divine right is not conferred on the monarch. It is conferred on the people as a whole.
Well, but that's precisely the error I was just identifying. If you can suck one right out of your thumb and call it divine, why can't you say, well then, oysters have the same right, that it comes from their creator. There is no, as you yourself have pointed out, with the rights industry, no real limit to this, especially if you attribute it to the divine. Generally speaking, though, the struggle for rights is a struggle for humans to assert themselves against other humans who want to oppress them in the name of God.
Do you mean, sir, that we do not have, and it's me again, the questioner.
Yes, sir.
Do you mean then?
You suddenly seemed a little, what shall I say?
Omniscient?
It just came from somewhere else. That's it. Gave me a nasty turn. Yes, please, go ahead.
Do you mean then that we do not have any innate rights towards each other other than what we assert by force? Did I hear you right? Or did I hear you wrong?
I tend to agree with those who've said that the concept of right, of recht, is a human creation, that it's an arbitrary creation, yes. And that we'd be better to say that we get the ones we fight for, that we don't get the ones we don't, and that our duties are, and solidarities with each other are mandated by evolution and are not in any sense predicated on anything supernatural.
Thank you. Sir?
Yeah, my question's looking a little bit more forward. You mentioned earlier, imagine if Jesus Christ had been proven to no longer be God or God's son. Imagine, if you will, a future where science is accepted as a total dogma of thought and reason is the ultimate arbiter. In that world, would humanity not find its own ways to tribalize again and have its own strife? There's a TV show, South Park, has a funny episode about this, where they actually say, in the future, they fight over science as opposed to fighting over God. And for you, Mr. D'Souza, in the same way, in a world without God, is it really so unimaginable? I mean, is there a possible way, could you imagine a future without it in the sense of humanity still being humans? And I'd also be remiss to say, in the great tradition of these debates, is it possible that you gentlemen might be able to go to a pub after this and continue over beers I'd be happy to buy?
On the second point,
I think it's as certain
as anything can be that I'll be in a bar an hour. Dinesh, quite often, Dinesh and his wife have often joined me there. On your point, my view of the mammalian evolution of our species is that we are programmed to be superstitious. Religion is unvanquishable, unbanishable, as long as we're partly irrational, as long as our prefrontal lobes are too small, our adrenaline glands are too large, and our opposing thumbs are still too clumsy. Of course, people can be sold every kind of delusion. I half agree with G.K. Chesterton when he said that people don't believe in God. They don't believe in nothing but in anything. I believe that the belief in God is a belief, willingness to believe in anything. But if you take Orthodox religion away, you may very well find someone worshipping a pet rock, or a tame fish, or a crystal, or some New Age nonsense healing process. Yeah, that's the way a lot of people are. I just would like to say that there's a solid minority of us who are not impressed by any of this. And we're citizens too. And deserve that much respect. A tiny thing, just to reignite the disagreement that Dinesh and I have. He said science is based on reason. I don't think that's absolutely necessarily true, because humans aren't based on reason. Newton, for example, believed that the Catholic Church was Antichrist, and that only Protestantism was true, and that the Trinity meant that you shouldn't be allowed to teach at Cambridge University if you believed in it, for example. Joseph Priestley, the discoverer of oxygen and carbon monoxide, believed in the phlogiston theory. Alfred Russel Wallace, Darwin's great collaborator, and maybe progenitor, was never happier than going to a spiritualist seances. A lot of these religious people, scientific minds, were terrific crackpots. It's not until Einstein, really, that you get something like pure mind as a scientific expression. I would prefer to say that science bases itself on evidence as well as reason, and that's the missing term in Christianity and Islam and Judaism and the rest of it. A good scientist will say, here's what I'll tell you now in advance would prove me wrong. Here's what I think is the case. But if you find this, I'll tell you now, I'll climb down. So for evolution, there is no religious believer who can do you that service, who can say to you, show me this and I'll stop believing. It's never been done. In the nature of the thing, it couldn't be done. The E word for religious people is essentially meaningless. It's occasionally convenient. Sometimes they think they'd like some evidence, usually in the form of miracles, because faith always turns out to be not quite enough. Let's have a bit of evidence, a tiny bit. I forget which scientist said. Scientist of evolution said, okay, what would make you stop? What would make you say you were wrong? Rabbit bones in the Precambrian layer. That would do it. Find me a rabbit bone there. It's all over. The debates between Dawkins and Gould on punctuated evolution, for example, are as intense as any debate has ever been between schismatic Catholics, Protestants, Sunni and Shia Muslims, or anything of this sort, except that they're all decidable on evidence as well as reason. That's what makes all the difference. All the difference.
Here's the problem with that statement. There are the biggest questions of life. Who are we? Why are we here? Why is there a universe? What's our purpose? What comes after death?